Thank you again for being here. For those that are online, I'm glad you're here today. I'm going to get right into the Word of God this morning. I want to read a, it is my life verse. It is the portion of Scripture that I structure my life on. And from the time I was a young man, this has been the verse that I turned to. It's a very familiar portion of Scripture. But I think it's really relevant in the times that we're living in. It's Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in or lean on and be confident in the Lord with all your heart and with mine. And do not rely on your own insight or understanding. In all your ways, know, recognize, and acknowledge Him, and He will direct and make straight and plain your paths. I love that verse of Scripture. And then I want to read one other portion of Scripture from Psalm 20 and 7. And this verse of Scripture God laid on my heart, and it's been a verse that has been weighing on me for some time. I pray it a lot here lately. Some trust in and boast in chariots, and some in horses. But we will trust in and boast of the name of the Lord our God. I want to speak on this thought for just a moment. In God we trust. And there's a question mark, the emphasis in the way that I made that statement. In God we trust. And it's more of a question than a statement. It should be a statement, but unfortunately, it's a question. Bow your heads, please. Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for those that have gathered, both in this building and those that are a part of our online campus that are watching today. I pray that you take the words of this simple man and that you would twist them as they leave my heart and my lips, and that you would orchestrate them into the hearts, and the minds, and the souls of those that set in this audience today and watch online. My words alone are inadequate and insufficient, but when the power of the Holy Spirit mixes in, it transforms ordinary words into conviction, into power, into anointing that can move into a heart and change a direction and a destiny. And we desperately need this in a culture that is struggling to trust. We ask your help today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. This generation, and I talk to young people and I witness it, I don't know that there's ever been a generation that has to struggle with the idea of trust and confidence than this generation does. It seems as everything that we would put trust and confidence in those that are older, it's falling apart in this generation, that it's harder and harder to put trust in things. Just this, in the last 24 hours, I've always had trust issues with the weather forecasters in central Indiana. No confidence in them. We use an app, AccuWeather, and it was promising me up to 8 inches. There was excitement that just the possibility that the storm of storms was going to hit. We were here in prayer and we left a little after 8 and we got in the car and it was joy beyond unspeakable joy in the car. The roads were just covered with snow. We had Christmas music playing. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. And it was coming down so hard, and it was just, we couldn't even go home. We just had to drive. But there was still this sinking suspicion inside of me, because my particular app has the confidence level, and the 8 and above indicator was at about 8%. The 4 to 8 was at 70%. The 2 to 4 was at about 12%. And then the less than 2 inches was at 1%. And they failed us. No confidence. Not that I didn't want to have church, but here we sat. Because the weather forecasters once again missed the mark and the snow didn't hit. But that's just a small indicator that I don't know if there's anybody really in Central Indiana that has any confidence in the weather forecasters. But this generation deals with much more serious issues. Do we trust in the government? How many have a confidence in the government that whether it was the previous administration or the one that is there now, that they're somehow really going to change the culture, they're going to change the direction of this country? I would imagine, especially in the younger generation, that the confidence level is so low in our government. Do we have confidence in politicians that what they actually say will be actually what they do? Again, our confidence level is so very low. Do we have confidence in media? Do you have your favorite news outlet that you watch, and how confident are you in them? Do you trust them totally, that they don't have agenda, that they don't have a bias, that they don't have a perspective that they're trying to push? I've got to the place where I basically have to turn it off. I can't take hardly any of them because they all seem to be driving agenda. And I've wondered, where did news go and when did it just become their opinion that they are trying to force on you? And lost trust, I lost confidence, and we have in that. How many of you have trust in social media, that what they put on is true, that everything that you read and see? Is there a reason that people have to put on their photos on Instagram? No filter. Is there a reason that they'll say, this is not edited, this is actual? And how many people here knows about the website called Snoops, where you go and proof text everything? And then how about how many of us have, we get the marketing calls over and over, and the phones that once, what we loved about our cell phone is that we only got calls from people we knew, and now they, I don't even know how they do it. They're putting names on there that I don't even have in my contact list, and I'm losing confidence in the ability to be able to segregate my cell phone, and it goes, you see what's happening over and over and again in society. And how about all those things that you see on TV that are going to be the latest and greatest, best invention? I have fell for those things so many times. I've been in the store. Shoppers, you got to come and see the knives. And you go and you're just convinced because they slice them. I don't know what they do in between the ones that they use and the ones you get. You try to slice it, they just slice the tomato and it's perfect. You go home and it's just squeezing juice out everywhere. And so you lose confidence in that, and we lose confidence in, how many have job security right now? You feel like absolutely there's nothing that's going to happen. Nothing can impact your job. Trust. We struggle with it in almost every area of our life, that our education, and I feel sorry for young men and women that are headed to college right now with this confidence that, and some that have just graduated, that when you come out, that four-year degree will somehow open a door for you and you're going to land the perfect job. And we're finding over and over, we'll go into restaurants and talk to people and they're, well, I have a four-year degree, but I'm working at Chili's, or I'm working at Starbucks, or I'm working, and we've lost confidence that even the education that we're getting is somehow going to create the environment and open the doors, and over and over. And how about our police departments? Do you have confidence in your police departments? What we've faced over the last year or so, we've seen, and what's really good and what's really bad? You see, everything that we our scene, our society is challenging our ability to trust, to have confidence in anything. We can't even trust churches. We can't trust religion. We can't trust pastors. Thank you, Carl Lentz, Hillsong, New York. You did a wonderful job for us because you presented this and you reached out to Justin Bieber and you reached out to Hollywood stars, and now you have shown yourself, and it absolutely destroys confidence that people might have had in church and may have a younger generation. Oh, it's another sham. It's just another person making money. They had no morality. They had no values. And how about people that have walked into our church over and over? I've known for the longest time sometimes when people walk in, it's going to be months, it's going to be years before maybe I can begin to gain some confidence, because you have been hurt at a church, you've been hurt by a ministry, you've been hurt by something, and somehow I've fragilely got to try to walk through this and live the moral life and live a life of character and do it right. So somehow, once again, it's sometimes I feel like you almost have to take the lives that walk into this building and lift them up and start building a foundation of trust again, because they've been so hurt by faith and religion. And I'm not here to be that. Now we're just like feeling all depressed. What's the worst? Let's just go home and go to bed. No, that's not the answer that I'm trying to. But I'm trying to show you that the failures of our society, of our world, has brought our generation, this young generation in particular, to a place where they have very little confidence in anything. They question almost everything. There's an attitude of fear. There's anxiety. There is doubt. There's lack of trust. And in particular, it bleeds over in one area. When all those other institutions begin to fail that we once had confidence in. And we did have confidence in our governments at one point. We did have confidence that police were good people. And I'm not here to put all the police in the same category, but that because of the failure of some, it has brought a negativity to the whole. And so here we are with that, and it begins to bleed into our belief and our trust and confidence in God, knowing this was the message I was going to preach and not knowing the songs that the worship team had planned this morning. As I was listening to their songs and I was observing the audience, I sensed even in this audience a lack of faith, a lack of trust, a lack of confidence in what was being sang. Yeah, I'm singing this, but I don't know that I have a lot of confidence. I don't know that I have a lot of trust. And that bothers me, and it overwhelms me sometimes that somehow we've, as a culture, have got to get back to this place that we have a confidence in God, and it puts a great amount of pressure on me as a pastor, and it should make a great amount of pressure on pastors to make sure that everything that we do, that we try to do above board, we try to do right, and we're never really going to be perfect because we're humanity. But to do things right are so important, because even in interpersonal relationships, we've lost trust. There's too many people that even sit in our churches that are chameleons. And a chameleon changes their color by the person they're with. And so they'll be with you at your home, they'll be with you, and they'll say one thing in your presence. But how much confidence do you have that when they get in somebody else's presence, they'll say something differently? It's a spirit that has grabbed a hold of a generation that has lost confidence in all these other things. So if I don't have confidence in government, and I don't have confidence in media, and I don't have confidence in police, and I don't have confidence in education, and I don't have confidence in the stock market, then we oftentimes begin to become those chameleon people too. And God is challenging us to be real. That who you are with one group of people, especially in this church, and you go, you got to be the same person. I can't be a Sunday morning preacher and a Tuesday morning sinner. The confidence that people have in church has been lost, because we come and we show up on Sunday and we dress the part and we do our thing, but then we walk out and we act totally different. And the destruction of in God they would trust just wanes smaller and smaller and smaller. In your pocket, in your wallets, is money. If you look on that currency, our forefathers had the audacity, I guess some would say, but I would call it courage, to put something on our coins, to put something on our dollar bills. What does it say? In God we trust. In God we trust. To a young generation that may not realize that, that phrase, in God we trust, has been on American currency since the Civil War. In a time when there was no confidence in where our country was going, it was split into civil war. At that time, somebody began to put on the currency, in God we trust. And it just kind of made its way, and you go to places in Washington and you will see it on statues and monuments and in buildings, in God we trust. And to show you how far we've come as a culture and how different your government is today than it was not a long time ago, it was in 1956, on July the 30th, that President Dwight D. Eisenhower signed the law declaring the official phrase, in God we trust, to be printed on all American currency. In just a little over 70 years ago, our country said, in God we trust. Your government was willing to step out, and now they, if you even mention God in any kind of the vileness that is against you. But I love the concept behind why Eisenhower and why those of the Civil War wanted this phrase here. It was this. This was the essence of why. They said, we need to have this currency to do commerce in life, but we need to know that our confidence is not in the money. It's not, but our confidence is in God. I have to use this dollar bill. I've got to use this $20 bill. I've got to use these coins. But my confidence is not in the coins. My confidence is not in the dollar. My confidence is in God. And if there's anything that needs to happen, there needs to be this return to confidence in God. And it's going to take a miraculous work. God is going to have to show himself in a way to this generation, because the questions will not go away. The doubts that you have, and I'm not here to diminish you. I'm here to acknowledge that you're living in a different world than your parents and your grandparents. And to those that are parents and grandparents, don't berate your young people. They're living, you understand a little bit better now, they're living in a different world where there is no confidence. They don't have confidence in hardly anything. And so it's bled over into the church. They don't have confidence in God. They don't have confidence in his word sometimes. And some would think this is a new thing. But this morning I'm here to tell you this is not a new thing. Though culture has changed, the challenge to trust in God is an old challenge. That's why David said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him. Because all the way back at the time of David, there were challenges that caused him to question all kinds of things in his life. There has always been corruption in government. There's always been power-hungry people in religion. There's always been a societal bias. There's always been personal rejection. There's always been personal failure. So why trust? Maybe that's where it comes. And I had to work on this morning. So I went to the Word of God, and I turned to John and found a story of Jesus dealing, because Jesus in his time dealt with the same issues of trust that we're dealing with. And this particular story is the story you probably know well. It's when Jesus went to meet the woman at the well. He knows well in advance before he gets there the dynamics that he is going to face. He understands the cultural issue. He understands the biases. He understands the struggles. And so much that and he's intentional. Jesus is going to the well because he knows there is a woman that has trust issues that's going to come. And he is going to go at a time when normally you would not be at the well. But he knows this woman with these trust issues is going to be coming that place. And not only does he know that she has these trust issues, he knows that if he is going to have any influence at all, he's got to break down a lot of barriers of trust issues. So knowing that, the first thing he has to do is he's got 12 disciples with him that carry biases and ideas. And he realizes, I cannot go to this woman with this baggage. I can't go with these group of men because they have preconceived ideas. They're a little bit of that chameleon spirit that I talked about that can get into a church, that can get into groups of people that will treat one people one way and treat another people another way. And here's disciples that are, man, we're about fisher of men. But he knows, I am going to Samaria. I'm going to the place that, well, such a bias that the Jewish people would build their roads, and when they would come to the line, the state line or the territorial line where the Samaritans live, the road would literally stop right there to make sure you knew you didn't cross into that Samaritan territory. You couldn't even get the dust of the land of the Samaritans on your feet. That's the bias that the Jewish people, the culture carried that day. That will create a trust issue if you're a Samaritan, because you begin to know they don't like me. They don't trust me. My kind can't go to that store. My kind don't fit in their social circle. They've made it very obvious they don't want to have any part of me. And Jesus knows as they're going towards that direction, the disciples are going to have a problem with the person I'm going to talk to today. So I've got to send them away. I've got to send them to go get some bread. I've got to send them on a little bit of a journey so that I can get alone with this woman, because the only opportunity that I'm going to have to break down her trust issues is to get to her alone. And so Jesus sends them away, and he makes his way to the well, and he is there before she is. It's not morning time when all the rest of the ladies would come. It's later in the day because she is carrying such trust issues. She's so hurt by life and the pains of life, she cannot go when the other ladies go. Because she knows that as her shadow approaches the well, if she goes in the morning when everybody else goes, the whispering starts, the talk begins. Those people that would smile at her at the market suddenly are whispering as she approaches. You know who she is, and oh, here she comes. You better guard your husband, guard your children, because she is one of those people. 5 different men have been her husband, and the one she's living with right now is not her husband. The baggage of trust. Can you begin to see the trust issues this lady has? She's tried to trust that first time, to trust that husband. She's just like any other young person sitting in this room that wants to have the marriage, that wants it all to work out. And she has the same dream. If I can bring it 21st century, she wants the nice little home. She wants the dog and the cat and the children. She wants the perfect little home. You know how it looks. That's what she longs for. But somehow that first marriage does not work out. It destroys confidence. It destroys faith in God we trust, starts to go out. And somehow she picks herself out of that first marriage, that first brokenness of life that is so painful, and walls that have been built up. And a second time, she decides, I'm going to trust. I'm going to invest. This man seems to be the right man. And a second time, it fails. She is a strong woman, because she doesn't do that five different times. She tries to put confidence in a man, and the man, and we don't know all the stories, somehow the brokenness that is there, and now she's not even married, but she's got a man in her life. But I would suggest that morning, or that mid-morning or afternoon, as she heads towards the well and she sees Jesus sitting there, her pace stops. It slows down. Because once you've been hurt, everybody becomes questionable. It doesn't matter how religious you look. It doesn't matter your appearance from afar. Realize this, in a broken society, everything is in question. To trust anything is there, and we're there, folks. We're in a generation, we're in a time where we don't trust heart, we're going to question everything. It just seems too good. We've received too many keys in the mail that says, bring this to the dealership and you might win the car. If you're like me, I don't know how many keys I've had, and not one time. Can anybody else join me? Not one time have I ever went to the dealer. Is there anybody in this place that's ever went to the dealership to try out your key? Zero. Has anybody got a key besides me? Okay, there's been a few that's got the key. You see, confidence, once it goes, it just begins to destroy the ability to trust. And her pace slows. And she walks up and Jesus realizes, there's trust issues. I've got to break down a lot of barriers here before I ever get a chance with this woman. What? And she immediately identifies him. She walks up and the conversation starts and says, about the water. Jesus said, can I have a drink? And the first question, because there's so much angst, there's so much anxiety, there's so much, why are you a Jew? Do you see the problem right here? Right at the very beginning? Why are you a Jew talking to me? Don't you know that's not legit? That you can't, you're not allowed to talk to me. I'm not allowed to look to you. I'm not allowed to have any part in your life. What are you doing even talking to me? He's got to break down a barrier of social injustice. He's got to break down the barrier, and he just keeps working at the moment. And then there's another question. How? This is her first question. How is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink? For I am. I know who I am, and I know that I got a trust issue with you. I'm not good enough. You have your type has a bias against me. Jesus just keeps having to press through that. In John 4:11, he says, I'll give you something to drink. And she looks and says, you have nothing to draw with. Where are you going to get this living water? Again, just another part of the wall that Jesus is trying to be. She is not going to, as broken as she is, as bad as things are, she is not lowering the walls down for Jesus. She's not giving him a chance. He said, I'm offering you a water that you'll, now you don't have anything to draw with. I've been approached by too many emails. I've got too many texts now. I've seen too many infomercials. What are you trying to sell me? I don't trust you. I don't have confidence in you that anything, you're a Jew. You have a bias against me. Now you're trying to push religion. And all I've ever experienced from religion is hurt. When they see my situation, they look at me in disdain. There is no grace. There is no mercy. There is no forgiveness. Why would she trust? Jesus presses on. And he begins to talk about himself. In John 4:12, if you look later, she will ask this question: "You are not greater than our father Jacob, are you?" Jacob was, that was the beautiful time. That's when things were right. That's when I had the ability to try. What was she saying? This was a time when I had confidence. It was way back that I had faith and confidence. And over, Jesus has to continue to ask. And Jesus then says, "Well, go get your husband." And still, as broken, as shattered as her life is, she's unwilling to bring the walls down. She says, "I don't have a husband." And here is the moment that things begin to change. When she withheld the information, Jesus said, "You're right. See, this is what we've got to have. And we've got to pray. We've got to begin to gain is that God is God. And as bad as he has been marketed by religion, by churches, and by faiths that you have walked out of, and organizations, you have to have a confidence that God is God. And that confidence can only come by a move of God that changes your heart, that allows the walls to be broken down. And I don't know exactly how we get there, but we've got to pray as a church, we've got to pray as individual that God will help walls to begin to break in our society, because there's got to be something that we have confidence and we have trust in. And may I say, the one thing that I believe that we can hold true to: in God I trust. I trust him with my life. I trust him with my heart. I trust him with my children. I trust him with my marriage. I trust him in my home. I trust him above education. I trust him above my finances. I trust him above my... In God I trust. In that moment when Jesus speaks to her, a personal revelation is the greatest need in this church. It's the greatest need in every Christian life. To have a moment when God just becomes real. When it's no longer the church you attend or the pastor that's over you. It's not the organization, it's not the name, it's not the cool place to be, but you have found God. You have found this place where God is real, that God is authentic, and nothing can ever take that away. In this moment of time, Jesus has done everything he can to overcome, and finally he just says, "You know what, I'm going to have to give you a personal touch." And it's this moment when she speaks and withholds and the walls are not coming down. He said, "You're right. You haven't had one husband, but you've had five, and the one you're living with, the man, is not your husband." And suddenly revelation hits her. "I can trust. I can trust this man." And the conversations begin to unfold, and he tells her about a river, a water of life that he can give her that will cause her to never thirst again, and that the fulfillment that she's longed for, that she hasn't found in men, and where she hasn't found it in society, and where she hasn't found it, it's in God. And I'm here to tell somebody that very same thing. What you need is in God. You are in the right place today, being in the house of God, hearing the word of God, hearing the songs of God. Your hope as a generation is in God. You trust. That is it. This woman comes and listens to his words and listen to the transformation. Listen to the transformation. And I got the scriptures. I want you to see this. The same woman that walls are so high, the biases, the personal attacks, the people that treat her one way in one setting and treat her another in another setting, all that comes tumbling down in the presence of a real God. Oh God, that we might see you and your realness. In that moment, she sees. And notice this, I want to read John chapter 4, verse 39. The woman that had to come to the well. The woman that had to come to the well in the afternoon. The woman that had to come to the well alone. The woman of the well that didn't have any friends. The woman that was so hurt that I don't know how long the conversation took for Jesus to begin to gain her trust. Now look at the conversation. Now, numerous Samaritans from that town believed in and trusted in him because of what the woman said. Only Jesus can break down some of the walls that are in your life. When she declared and testified, he told me everything that I ever did. Next verse, please, next few verses. So when the Samaritans arrived, they asked him to remain with them, and he did stay there 2 days. What was he doing? He was building confidence. We're a people that don't have any value. We're a people that nobody has wants to spend time with. But Jesus said, you are worth something. You can trust me. I'm not going to bail on you. And then many more believed in and adhered to and relied on him because of his personal message, what he himself said. I'm here to tell a group of young people. I'm here to tell a culture that has lost trust and confidence in so much. You can trust God. I'm not asking you to trust me. I'm not asking you to trust everything about this church. I'm not asking you to trust everything about religion. But I am challenging you to put your trust in Jesus Christ. Put your trust and confidence in him that he will never leave you, that he will never forsake you. You will have tests, you will have trials, but you can trust in God. You can trust in God. Many more believe because of his word. I'm calling people as I come to a close this morning to trust in God again. I'm not asking you to trust me. I hope you do have some confidence. And if there's things that you don't trust, make sure you get what you don't trust from me. And not the opinions of other hurt people in this room. Because people will say stuff about us. I'm cool with that. I'm not perfect. And that's not the point of this message. But don't put so much confidence in just what people say about your pastor, about your church, about what they believe. At some point, you just have to know for yourself and have a confidence. For years, and I'm so past that I hate to bring it up. People have challenged me, my wife, and this church almost from the inception. They don't believe water's wet and grass is green. Careful who you listen to. Be careful listening to everyone. Don't put all your confidence in me either. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, some in organizations. But David said, remember the name of the Lord. Trust in Him. Long actions, or actions over long periods of time, so is what should give you confidence. It has been said, we don't baptize people in the name of Jesus. It's the only way we've ever put people down in water here. It's been said we don't believe in the infilling of the Spirit with the language unknown. We do. And it says, will you come to this church? There's absolutely no rules. No, because that's incorrect too. There's relationship, and relationship has rules. Rules for rules are worthless, but when I have relationship, there will be things in place. And every married person in here knows there are rules in your marriage. And if you cross one of them this morning, you had a long drive to church. I don't know if it's don't leave your socks or your dirty clothes, but there's rules for some of you. When I got married, I found out very quickly there were rules. There were certain things that were going to be a certain way. And Mary found out there were certain ways that were going to be certain. But we abide because we're in relationship. And the strongest relationship is, you know, the depth of this church for me is amazing. And I didn't intend for this message necessarily to go this way. People, they come here and they just do anything. No, when people come to Life Connections, I hope they become authentic. I hope they become genuine. Because when you just do something for the sake of religion and for the sake of the rituals, you don't have ownership of it. And if you don't have ownership of it, people are going to see right through it. And they're not just simply not going to trust you. They're not going to trust your God. Because it's going to seep out another part of your life. Well, I do this at the church, but I don't. And it just brings question. But when we become authentic, and when our relationship with God is real, then it changes everything. It changes the post on the Facebook. It changes the post on the Instagram, because I'm in relationship with God. And so what people see here on Sunday morning needs to be what people see at the Walmart. It's what they need to see at the Kroger. Why? Because they need to see that they can trust in God, and that the life you profess on a Sunday is the life you live through the week. Your life must say, in God, I trust. That's the power of our witness. When it's lived out, not a bullhorn and bumper stickers, but just an authentic life lived out. Why was Jesus able to break the walls in that woman's life? He authentically touched her. Suddenly, all the trust issues that she had built up. And as bad as some of your lives here, I don't think there's anybody that can say, five husbands, living with the six, and it is a mess. And so if God can break down those walls for that lady, I'm here to tell you, He can break down the walls of those that are in your circle of people. Simon Peter had the ability to trust God. How do you gain that ability to trust God? You had to spend enough time with Him that you gain confidence in Him. He had fished all night long. He was weary and tired. He knew more than Jesus would ever know about fishing in the human sense. Exhausted and cleaning his nets. But Jesus walks into the photograph of the story. How's fishing? Not so good. Well, why don't you go out one more time? And this gives you an idea of the confidence, the trust in God. He trusted that he had spent enough time that when Jesus said it, even though he was exhausted and the nets were clean and had fished all night and it had been a terrible, terrible night, these words are the words I hope that we can begin to meld into our lives in 2021. It's the words of Simon Peter that said, God, I trust you. Nevertheless, one word. Nevertheless, God, you said it. So here we go. And when we get to that place that regardless of how bad life has been and how bad culture is right now, I trust in God, all of a sudden things begin to change. I'm here to say, just cast out one more time. And when they cast out and that put that confidence in God one more time, they put those nets back out and it filled the boat so full of blessing. The boat began to sink and they got another boat and that began to almost sink. I'm here to tell you, your hope in this life is to trust in God. Stand with me. A different communion service. This Last Supper. The Last Supper was a challenge to trust when it doesn't make sense. The Last Supper was a challenge to trust when it hurts beyond your greatest pain. The Last Supper is the ability to trust when you fail. Do I still trust in Jesus Christ? That is what the Last Supper, he's bringing them together in this last moment, and he's getting ready to tell them, life is not going to make sense. You are going to fail me. There's going to be pain beyond your greatest imagination. I'm going to go to a cross. There's going to be a crucifixion. You're going to see me go to a grave. You're going to hear me crying. You're going to scatter all over the place, but still trust in me. And I'm going to give you a reminder that this is how real I am. I'm going to give you a piece of bread. We're going to break it off so that you'll remember to trust me, that my broken body will do enough for you. I'm going to give you a cup and you're going to drink from it, because I want you to know you can trust that my blood, regardless of your sin, regardless of your mistake, regardless of the failure, regardless of where you were last night, regardless of the addiction you're struggling with right now, trust in God. Let the walls come down and trust in God. Simon Peter, I know you're going to fail me three times, but trust in the bread. Trust in the blood. You guys are going to run away, but trust in the blood and trust in the bread. And so this morning, I challenge this church to take of the cup and to take of the bread, not because of who you are, not because you somehow can validate your worth, but when you take it this morning, you are saying, I trust in God.